So these are the helpers for the farmers. But now, like in the United States, and they say, oh, it's higher yields and it's better this, better that. But in the United States, after 10 years of use of BT of GM crops in the United States, the United States Department of Agriculture, the top body in the United States, the government organization for agriculture, a big GM promoter always, in the back pages of their website, you can find the document, the first decade of GM in the United States. And in that document, they state, our yields now are not higher than they would have been without GM. Our chemical use now is not lower than it would have been without GM. The profits per hectare now for the farmer are not higher than they would have been without GM. The only reason why our farmers are using GM is ease of management, convenience, ease of use. Not any production improvement. And then these are still the empty promises that all the gene jockeys, all the geneticists talk about. Oh, we'll get genes for higher yields. We get more growth with less fertilizer, like less nitrogen fertilizer. We get drought, acidity, salinity tolerance. All those aspects we can put in the genes and we can make better crops. More nutritious food. And pharma crops, like medicine, into plants, that we can grow plants and we have natural medicines then growing in a paddock and we can harvest that for medicinal purposes. They were making these promises 20 years ago. They're still promises. They haven't delivered. Because these interactions are so complex in the genes, where all the genes are talking with each other. It's not a single gene or two genes. It's a very complex system. But in the meantime, all those geneticists, all the scientists, they can write like 10 scientific papers. And they're happy because they get promotions, they get good scientific papers. But there's no result for us citizens and consumers. So it's all these promises, better returns for the farmer, better environment and human health, and feed the world. And that's an emotional blackmail that the science world uses. And like our Minister of Foreign Affairs, Kevin Rudd, was saying that last week as well. We need the GM to feed the world. It's complete nonsense. It doesn't feed the world. Because we have to go with the natural genes for our current plants and go to the soil as the solution, as I come back in my talk as we continue. So the problems with GM on the land, like they don't improve soils. Soils is the biggest factor in our farming system right around the world. Soils are being degrading. So we have to uplift our soils, we have to make our soils more fertile to make the crops better. And that's what we do with organic farming, that we increase the soil fertility to make better food. So GM doesn't do that. So if you put a GM crop on a worse soil, you still get bad production. And then we have seed contamination, the seed mix. And like Steve will talk about, after my talk, Steve will talk about that practical example on his farm in Western Australia, where the GM canola was mixed with the non-GM. And then the long-term impact. Like all these studies have been done for 3 years, 5 years. But we don't have science for the long term. Not multi-generational feeding studies. Not what that GM gene will do in the landscape. How it will cross into wheat species, animals, etc. That study has not been done. And that's the biggest unknown that we have to know an answer for. And then there are now new diseases. Like in the United States last year, there was a new soybean disease. A disease that was never there before. That an emeritus professor in the United States went back to that disease and he described it. And he was an expert in the field when he was an active professor. And he described it as a new disease, a new gene mix from the old genes of the old disease making a new one. And we, of course, in the news, we've heard all the stories about the E. coli in Germany with 35 people dying. That was like E. coli, where genes transferred between two species of E. coli. So those things are now happening with the introduced GM genes as well. And then weeds become resistant to herbicide. And that's a big problem like in the United States. Like with all those GM-tolerant crops, they spray the herbicide, but now they get so many resistant weeds that they can't kill. So you get, and like these growing cotton fields, and then when those weeds grow and they can't use a herbicide to kill it, that the cotton harvester can't cut the stems of those trunks of the wheat. So they have to get labor in, manual labor, to cut those trunks out before they can put the harvester in. That's now the GM cotton world in the United States. So all the solutions that the farmers were addicted to are not working. And then the United States Food and Drug Administration, the scientists in the drug administration, they were warning about the GM crops like 30 years ago for allergens, toxins, new diseases, nutritional problems in humans. But all those scientists that queried the GM and wanted to know answers, they were just pushed down, dismissed, not listened to. It was the chemical companies, the pharmaceutical companies that have the power in our society. See, what can affect human health? So we have the toxins like glyphosate that's in the, like the herbicide tolerant crops have toxins in there that stop the plant being affected by the herbicide. And now, like, they spray the herbicide so much that, like, in Argentina, there are now professors that have written scientific papers of misformed babies of women that live in the land where the sprays are happening. And they get all the negative impacts on the next generation of babies. Animals become infertile. Then the BT, like the BT is the toxin that stops the insects eating the crops. And like the BT is used by organic farmers, BT spray, to kill insects. And that's what the scientists always say about the BT in GM canola, which stops the insects eating canola. They say, oh, the organic farmers have always used the BT. What does the organic farmer do? They spray BT once, and then insects die. The cotton plant with BT, the GM cotton plant with BT, produces the toxin every day of the year in every green tissue of the plant. And that tissue then decomposes, and then the science says, oh, it degrades, the BT toxin is not active in the environment. But now in the United States, in the Midwest, they have measured BT toxin free in the waterways. It doesn't decompose, it doesn't break down anymore. Because that's like with biology, if you use something season after season, year after year, you get different reactions all the time. And now the BT toxin is free in the environment. Another study in Canada showed the BT toxin in the blood of people. And like in pregnant mothers, they found the BT toxin in the blood. So that goes to the fetus. What happens then? So all these stories about it's safe, it's safe, it's safe, it's falling apart. So gene, and then with the gene transfer, like all those, like the genes, the antibiotic gene and the viral gene that they need for the selection procedure, they can transfer in the gut bacteria, the viral gene and the antibiotic gene. And that's what they call horizontal gene transfer. Horizontal gene transfer is without any sexual activity. The genes can just go from one body to another body. And that's happening, can happen in the gut. And then the mice study, like a GM-fed mice study, and like all the studies that are on the multi-generational feeding studies that are on in the international literature are all done by independent scientists, because the organized science that does the GM doesn't get money to publish negatives about GM. So these independent scientists, as soon as a scientific paper comes out with negatives, they're over clobbered over by hundreds of scientists saying, oh, you stupid, you did that wrong, you did that wrong, that's wrong. And I didn't tell those scientists, like in CSIRO, I told them, okay, if you say that this is wrong, show me, do the trial yourself, and show me that it's safe. I still haven't seen that study. So you get problems in the pancreas. The other thing that our regulator, like our gene regulator in Canberra, they ask for a feeding study of at least 30 days. So you can feed animals for 30 days with GM, no problem, good, we release it. They don't cut animals open, they don't look in the inside, they don't have a second generation, it's all not required. So here you can see problems with the pancreas, liver cells damage, fertility problems, and altered gene expression. These are rats, like the big one is on normal soy, the small one is on GM soy. 19-day rats. And like that's from Irina Ermakova, a Russian scientist. And when she published that information, she was completely clobbered all over the world that she was not a biologist, she couldn't know anything about it, and she was wrong, she did wrong, used the wrong methodology. She's a no-hoper. But she was in a Russian institute of high standing, and she was doing that research with all the supervision by experts. And then other rat study, precancerous cell growth in the digestive tract, smaller brains and testicles, partial degeneration of the liver, immune system damage. And like the liver is always the clue. Like in all the studies where they cattle open animals that have eaten GM, the cattle open animal, the liver, and the liver has changed. Big impacts. What does the liver do in our body? Detoxifies. The liver is our detoxifier. So if the liver breaks down and can't cope, what does that mean? That the food is not healthy. So this is our food standards of Australia and New Zealand, our food authority in Canberra. And they have been saying, oh, no problem with oil. Like canola oil is safe. We don't have to worry about GM. Cotton oil, we don't have to worry about GM. Like a cotton oil is made in the ice cream industry as well. Cotton oil is in our food. They say, don't worry. But this is the study that proved that. They say in the press release, the sense that the canola oil and cotton oil, they contain no protein, no GM. On page 7 of the report, they say not considered to contain. On page 18, they say all protein is virtually removed. And then on page 25, the total protein in field trials was 0.29 parts per million. So there is protein, there is GM in the oil. But like 0.3 parts per million, it's so little, we don't have to say it's there. But if we give somebody with a peanut allergy a sniff of peanuts, they go bang. So we have to be very careful with all this kind of analysis, that our food authority says no problem, but it is a problem.